Guys, welcome back to Let's Be Frank, the home of men's mental health, with myself, Jack Coward, and Mr. Ryan Smith. Again, today we have another incredible special guest who we will be introducing very shortly. But as always, Mr. Ryan Smith, how are we doing, mate, on this fine, it's all wet weather evening for me here?
Yeah, I think it's not too bad outside at the moment, but obviously it's like there's been a bit of rain all day, but we're good now. And I actually say I'm a little bit nervous on this one. I know I've said it the last couple of ones, but this one, I've been following their YouTube channel for some time now, and to see him like here on the camera, it's like, wow, let's go. So yeah, so guys, I want to introduce Josh from Resort TV One. I mean, his channel started in 2008, posting just like informal videos around Disney. A few years later, Resort TV One was born. I'm sure he'll share that story with us, how that came about. And then in the years that followed, his sister Jenna joined the channel. And in 2017, YouTube went live, started doing live streaming. So naturally, Resort TV One sort of started to do weekly broadcasts from Disney, with the channel attracting now over 170,000 followers, with weekly sort of channels, well, weekly sort of, I don't normally do this one. So yes, it's normally Jack. So weekly sort of episodes, we'll call them, attracting nearly 3,000 Jack, I don't do these. This is live. So yeah, weekly sort of. Where was I? I think I'm going to hand over to Josh here because it's. I'm messing all this
it's
up. So
Josh,
how many
people
do you get on an episode?
Josh, I love this because he is starstruck, and it's amazing for me to see this.
Well, thank you so much, first of all, for having me on. And, you know, it's so funny because we've been doing this for a while, but even meeting people in the parks and having them be a little bit starstruck is still a little bit, you know, kind of surreal to me because, you know, to me, I'm still just Josh. And, you know, when I'm at home with my family, you know, I'm just Josh and that's just the way it is. It's, I guess, similar to how, you know, Josh Gad was saying that his kids weren't even that impressed that he was Olaf. So, you know, it's a kind of that kind of idea. But no, honestly, it's been amazing. And we have been doing this since 2017, like you said, a weekly live broadcast in the parks. And now it's become like twice a week, three times a week. It's just kind of snowballed from there. And we're getting close to 180,000 followers and just super excited to see what the future holds.
No, it's massive, and it's not just Resort TV One, is it? You've got, there's multiple channels now, so you've got Resort TV One Homes, you've got your retro station, which, you know, I've seen a few of the videos, and I do like the sort of nerdy side of things. You've obviously, Jenna's got her own sort of stuff in the background as well, and you have regular appearances of Mom and Dad as well, which I think as a family, as a unit, how you go out and, you know, you do your stuff with your family, and then Jenna does stuff with her partner and stuff, and then Mom and Dad come into it, but then I just think it's marvelous, and yeah, it's just brilliant. So how did it all start?
So it really, a lot of it was very much by accident, not intentional. I started out being just a, you know, another person who loved Disney and who missed Disney when I wasn't there. Just had that what we call post-Disney depression when you'd go home and leave a trip. And anybody who's gone to Disney knows that feeling for sure. And so this is way back. I lived in Indiana still. And I just started getting on the internet to see, well, what's out there? You know, YouTube hadn't even really fully started yet. And I found all this audio and video from Disney parks. And I was like, oh my goodness, this is the music from Epcot. This is the music from this. This is a video of the ride. And, you know, it was amazing to me to find all this stuff. Fast forward a little bit, I would go back to Disney and say, well, I want to make some videos too. So next time I went, the next year, I started making some videos, posting them on these kind of informal message board type things. It wasn't YouTube. It was just a very informal site for posting videos in very low quality, but it was like really cool at the time. And then somebody finally on one of these websites, it was BitTorrent, if you're familiar with that. And a lot of people can't access that because colleges had blocked it and all their service providers had blocked it. And they said, we love your videos, but like, could you post it on YouTube? And I was like, yeah, I don't know much about YouTube. I have a Google account, you know, at the time, Gmail or whatever. But yeah, sure, I can post on YouTube a little bit. So I post on YouTube a little bit. And, you know, I didn't think much of it. Just posted a few messages or a few videos here and there. But I kind of lost interest because there was a limit of 15 minutes per video. And a lot of the videos of different things that I had made were longer than that. And I didn't want to have to chop it all up into parts. And it just really was a lot of extra work. And so I lost interest for several years. But posted a few things in 2007, 2008. And then I don't know, just 2015, I looked and I was like, wait a minute, YouTube's offering me partnership and monetization. And like, I'm going to be a YouTube partner and I'm in the top whatever percent. Well, a couple of my videos I'd posted 7 years earlier or 6 years earlier had just taken off, but without my knowledge, to the point where they were going to start giving me ad revenue and just really like doing all these things to make it more legit. And I said, okay, this is weird. I don't know much about this, but sure, why not? If YouTube wants to give me a couple dimes for a video, it's fine. And so fast forward a little more, I was just started posting resort TV videos. That's when that kind of all started. I had recorded a lot of it as a kid. I love the resort TV that plays in the rooms. And I was always upset when one channel changed to a different host or a different format. And so I started recording them with just a VCR and eventually a computer and whatever I could record it with. Started posting those, and the only reason to post those on the channel was so I could play it on my own Apple TV in the house to pretend like I was at Disney.
See, I've done that myself. I'm at work, right? The wife's walking through the house, and all I've got is just that overlay with the temperature and everything else and the different things scrolling across. And yeah, I think it was your channel that actually found that on. So I think that's how I come across you guys. So yeah, thanks for that. And it's many hours of the wife been a bit dismayed by it. I think, yeah, thanks.
Oh, absolutely. Can you still hear me?
Have we froze? I think we froze then.
Yes. Okay. Yeah, sorry.
The fund is back.
We completely lost power. Here. Okay. We lost power. Sorry.
You're good.
So basically I was just saying, Josh, that I was in awe of your TV overlays and stuff, and it's been many hours of my wife like walking past the lounges I've been working and stuff. Brilliant.
Oh, absolutely. Well, so from there, it kind of fast forwarded on to all of a sudden those videos got really popular, the resort TV. And so I thought, okay, this is getting legit. We got close to 1,000. Well, we got over 1,000 subscribers. And at that point, you could pick a real channel name. Now you can pick it much earlier. But at that time, I think you had to have 1,000 subscribers to have your own URL and everything. And so I thought, well, let me just call it Resort TV because that's what we're doing right now a lot of. And I was also doing like videos around the hotels, just little tours. So let's just call it Resort TV. I didn't want to call it Disney or anything and, you know, run into any copyrights or anything like that. So I tried that. Well, YouTube said, no, you can't do Resort TV. That's weird. There isn't one, but they weren't going to allow me to do that. So I said, well, you know what? Resort TV 1 has a nice ring to it. Like, it's just like a TV channel, you know? So we named it that. That was before Jenna even came on board. And then I just started doing videos around the parks, construction updates when Disney Springs was being constructed out of, you know, the downtown Disney, what it was before. I've got a big series on that. And then finally, live streaming was where it really took off. And in 2017, live streaming became available. And I said, you know, I bet people would like to see the parks live. And the very first time I went live at Magic Kingdom, I'd gone live a few other times, but the very first time I went live at Magic Kingdom, we got over 1,000 concurrent viewers at the same time. And it was just mind blowing. People thought we were the official Disney broadcast. And I was like, no, I don't work for Disney, but this is cool. So that's when we decided that this could really have a future and could really go somewhere. It was pretty amazing.
So, yeah, I'm loving the sort of the multiple streams that you're getting now, and you're shooting back between the parks and stuff. It just seems out of every other channel, you're so far ahead of other people. You seem to just be on it. And if there's something new, you're there. And I just think that's remarkable. You can tell I'm a big fan.
Well, I appreciate it.
No, yeah, I've been trying to get Jack to start watching them, and it's like he's getting there. So, yeah, so Jack, anything from you? I know it's just been
for me. It's so interesting to kind of learn the backstory behind your journey. That's what I like to look at, is the journey. And you know, I've watched a few, and I'm still at a nighttime fighting like my partner and all my kids for the TV and trying to sit them down. But yeah, it's a nightmare because. You know what kids are like, they just want to run around and play hectic and whatnot. But for me, when you think when you started that this would be as big as it was, or did you go into it with kind of a business mindset to go, this could be massive and this is what we could do? Or did you go into it for the pure kind of love of what it was you was doing?
So yeah, that's a great question. Actually, we did go into it just for the pure love of it because, you know, literally when I started making videos, it was just a post for on a random website, you know, that wasn't, there was no monetary value at all to it. It was just for fun, just for people, basically like social media in early form of people saying, oh, great video, I love that, thanks so much. You know, the comments were really that was the payoff at that time, was just people commenting, wow, thank you so much, that's my favorite ride and stuff like that. And then even when it started out in YouTube, you know, I tell the story, the first couple times I live streamed, you know, I didn't even know anything about making money on YouTube at all. That wasn't even in consideration at first. And people were like, you should turn on Super Chat. And I'm like, what's that? You know, so we did several streams without even Super Chats, no donations, no nothing. It was just really fun. And so, you know, when the monetization came in, it was more at the beginning, you know, it was more to just say, okay, this could help cover our passes and cover our costs and whatever. That's another thing. A lot of people think we go to Disney for free and get everything for free. We don't. We pay just like everybody else does. Disney does invite us every once in a while to things, but we pay, I'd say 99.9% of the time, unless Disney's invited us to something, we're paying for everything just like a regular guest, which I like, because that way we can review it honestly and say, you know, hey, we used our own money to pay for this. This is what we think of it. So yeah.
It must be nice as well. Like, kind of, obviously, we know Ryan's getting starstruck, which is fantastic for me to see, because I can't wait to like edit this. It's going to be brilliant. But how is it now then for you when you very first started, obviously walking around the park, videoing? How is it now going to the park? You know, are you being recognized? Are people asking for photos? Are you enjoying that experience? Are you having, do you have moments where you're like, do you know what, today I just want to be kind of have a bit of space around me? Like, how is that for you? Because obviously everyone's going to find it kind of different, some scary, some not. So yeah, how is that feeling for you?
At first, it was weird. The first time somebody came up and tried and recognized me and tried and talk to me, I thought I was in the way. When they walked up, you know, at Disney, and I just started moving aside. You know, I was like, oh, I'm sorry, am I in your way? They're like, no, we want to say hi to you. I was like, oh, okay. So that was shocking. And now I've gotten more used to it, of course. I will say the times we get the most people coming up and talking to us is during the live streams, which is, makes it easier for them to find us, of course, in the parks. And at that time, you know, it's great to meet everybody. And the only time it ever gets overwhelming is when there have been times when there's been several people in a row that are kind of lined up. And I always just kind of like don't want to cause a scene at Disney or don't want to make anybody at Disney upset that we're like having an unofficial meet and greet. So we do try, if people get lined up, we're like, hey, find us in a minute. Like, let's not cause a, you know, and that's strictly just to keep things, you know, nice for Disney. We're happy to meet everybody and we never want to turn anybody away, of course. But, you know, that's, I think, the only time it gets overwhelming is when there's several groups trying to meet us at the same time. It's like, okay, let's talk for a minute and then let's go over here and, you know, kind of keep going. But otherwise, when I'm by myself at the parks or with Liam, you know, we might meet a couple people a day, but it's not overwhelming. It's really fine when we're with our families, and people are very respectful. And they usually, you know, if we're with our family, they keep, you know, they just keep it to a quick hello and take a picture. And that's good. Everybody's very, very respectful. And, you know, out of the hundreds of thousands of 180,000 people almost following us, it's insane that many people want to take time out of their vacation just to say hi or snap a photo. But it's really awesome. And I have YouTubers that I follow that I would love to meet too. So I kind of think about it when people are meeting me. I'm like, you know, how would I feel if I met this person that I've idolized for so long? And so I always try, even if I'm having a bad day or not in the mood or whatever, I want to try and give those people the same respect that I would expect if I was meeting somebody that I had really looked up to, because you only get that one chance to make a first impression, and we always want it to be a good one, of course. So
it's so true. And
the interaction between, you know, the way you are, it's,
yeah, you've got that energy that comes off really well and really welcoming. So I can see why people love what you do and want to come and say hello, because obviously we talk a lot about mental health on here, and I know it's helped Ryan a lot during like lockdown, and even now, to kind of have that moment to escape. That's what he kind of used it for, if I'm wrong, Ryan, by all means let me know. But he uses it, and I think a lot of people will as well use it as kind of an escape from the real world, to just have that moment to kind of a bit of clarity, a bit of downtime. And I think you'll be, you may know or you may be surprised, but especially like overhearing that, the amount of people that suffer with mental health have a love for Disney that will be watching your channel as a way for them to kind of, again, just have that moment of peace and enjoyment, and, you know, get the potential demons out of their head and them thoughts out of their head, and that they're using you, what you do, as part of that healing process. How does, if with that in mind, how does that make you feel?
It's really gratifying and even emotional for us at times to feel the full weight of, you know, that responsibility of providing that for people. You know, I think we do take that really seriously. And so, you know, not that we put pressure on ourselves too much, but we do understand that, you know, to a lot of people, this is more than just a Disney live stream. It really is therapeutic for people. And that is, you know, something we didn't realize at the beginning, but over time people would tell that to us. And a lot of times they tell us in person because it's hard to convey that in the chat. But somebody, you know, would come up and say, listen, like, you literally saved my life. I was having this really horrible time. And, you know, just watching your streams really just kept me going and just made me push forward. And you know, those kind of things is, that to me is worth, you know, more than anything we could ever do in our entire lifetime. Like, that to me is just priceless. You know, my favorite story is, I hope I can tell this without getting emotional, but my favorite story is, there's a gentleman, he's still in the chat and he doesn't mind me saying this. His name's Christopher Black. And his wife passed away from cancer very tragically at a very young age, not too long ago. And he came on the chat and sent a very generous super chat. And it was like, but then when I read the super chat, rather other than thanking the person for the donation, was the message that was way more valuable than the donation. And that was that his wife had been in hospice care. They knew she wasn't going to make it much longer. And they were sitting there watching the live streams while she was in hospice. They weren't chatting. They weren't, you know, interacting at that point. They were just spending time together as they should have been. But she loved Disney and she had a huge stuffed animal collection, Disney. They'd gone everywhere, but she couldn't travel, you know, for the past year or two of her life because of the sickness. And so, you know, she said, you know, she just felt like she was with us in the parks, you know, during those last few days, and that was just so comforting for them. He's like, you know, you've got a lifelong viewer in me because, you know, that what you did for her those last few days just make her last few days pleasant. I was just speechless after I read that, and I just was like, what could I ever even say, you know, to even just make sense of that or process that? But just, wow. And I just looked at him, and, you know, in the screen, I just, thank you for sharing that, because even if we're having a hard day and something's not working right, or the crowds are frustrating, or it's hot, or it's raining, or whatever's happening that gets you frustrated on a surface level, you know, those human needs that we have, I think, you know, when you think about somebody like that, who is literally living their last moments with their spouse, how much more important that is than just the small irritation of somebody bumping into you in the line or somebody being rude or whatever it is that we get frustrated about. That's the kind of thing that I try and keep up, you know, in my mind and fuel me whenever things get frustrating. It's like, okay, but there might be somebody out there who's not saying it, but they're enjoying the stream and it's taking their mind off something maybe that's truly, you know, horrible or heartbreaking. And if we can do that, then we can endure a minor annoyance so that they can have a little bit of peace, you know. So I don't know, it's just a huge thing.
That's incredible. And I know, you know, there'll be more stories out there like, you know, like that, which I, you know, we've, as a podcast, there's some of the stuff that we're getting in and whatnot, you know, we can relate to that. And I think, you know, taking something from that personally, I think is a massive thing. But knowing that, does it ever kind of affect your own mental health and that, Josh? Do you ever kind of, do you think, is there any point where you think, do you know what, I've had enough of this?
You know, that's a great question. And, you know, while there are times when I feel like I need a break, I never feel like I ever want to be done with it, because we get so much out of it too. You know, people always talk about how we help them. You know, we meet people all the time, and inevitably, almost every single time, they'll say, you helped us through the pandemic. And which was interesting to me because, you know, comparatively, we didn't have a lot of people watching those streams, but I think they were just watched, you know, kind of haphazardly when people had time. So they were watched later, maybe as recordings or whatever. But, you know, for us, that was therapeutic too, because I was sitting at the computer screen trying to get, you know, I'm a teacher, you know, trying to get kids to want to do anything. You know, everybody's motivation level was so low during the pandemic, and my motivation, you know, to teach, you know, was difficult as well. And I think whenever it was time for Friday Night Live and I could get the stream ready and we're going to get to ride some rides and talk Disney and all this. And I mean, it saved us too. You know, it was truly, I think just there was this feeling of being trapped, you know, in this room, actually, that I'm sitting in right now. And when I was on the stream, I didn't feel trapped anymore. And I think that was just the most powerful thing about it, was that I felt like I was really like getting out there to the world, and I didn't feel trapped anymore. And so I think that was the biggest thing for us, that I never felt like not doing it. Now, of course, it's different when you're out in the parks, but I think that, you know, it was as therapeutic for us as it was for everybody else. And I think a lot of people may not understand that, but obviously I'm still pretty emotional about it. So it definitely is, it's so valuable for us. I don't see us ever stopping doing it as long as we're physically able, because it helps us work through some things as well. So
I think you can see that, Josh. I was watching your facial expressions as you talk, as I do with all the guests that come on, just to kind of see their reactions on how they like answer and put themselves across. And for me, when you said that, it was like you had a moment of realization, because you were talking and then you sort of stopped yourself to go, oh, do you know what? Hang on a minute. And then continue. And for me, you've gone, you've all of a sudden gone like, I knew that, but for some reason it's just hit mm-hmm. me there that actually I've realized what how powerful it's been for myself in doing what I'm doing in Resort TV One, to the viewers, how it's helping them. And it's really powerful how a simple conversation can change and inspire others. So your conversation on Resort TV One, what you're showing people, is inspiring others. The conversations we have on the podcast, the reaching and inspiring others, and the power of conversation is really kind of it is real. How, with regards to mental health in men, as we cover it, what is that like overseas in America? What is the state, let's say, of men's mental health currently over there?
You know, it's interesting. I feel like it's probably pretty similar to where you guys are in the UK, but you know, there's the stigma, of course, you know. And I grew up you know, in the 80s and 90s, when it was like, rub some dirt on it and keep going, you know. And that was the way you dealt with things, and unfortunately that's not the best way to deal with things. We know that now. But you know, so I grew up with that, and you know, obviously breaking out of that, I think the channels helped me break out of that, because I will express things on the stream to thousands of people that I never would have expressed to anybody 20 years ago, you know, because I learned, you know, that wasn't okay. And now I'm relearning that it is okay to express those feelings when you have them, or, and maybe, and I think on the stream, I think about this too, like, what if somebody else is having exactly that feeling right now, and I can speak to that person? You know, we were watching a concert last night for King and Country, and one of the things they said on there was, I can't remember what was that. They were talking about, I just want to make sure that you feel seen and you feel heard tonight. And I thought, wow, what a powerful statement. You know, I mean, it's such a simple thing, and you hear people say it, and it could be considered cliche, but it just hit me in that moment. I was like, yeah, we do want people to feel seen, and we do want people to feel heard. And I hope that people feel that way when we watch the streams, if we can answer their chat. But, you know, it's interesting what you're talking about, you know, when I had that realization, I think it was, you know, interesting kind of looking back into my mindset during that time, during the pandemic, and like all of a sudden all the emotion of being trapped hit me at the same time. And it was like, but luckily we're not like that anymore and we're all fine. But I think, you know, realizing how important those nightly streams were to us, it's really, you know, really great. But as far as men's mental health, you know, I see a lot more people in the spaces that I watch, some of the YouTubers that I watch and some of the people that I talk to. There is a lot more acceptance, even of guys that would you consider, you know, a man's man, you know, athletes and people that you would consider to be very masculine or whatever, that are becoming more comfortable with sharing feelings. And I think I love it when I see big athletes, big stars, make comments that acknowledge mental health issues, or make a supportive statement to somebody, show up for somebody and do something that they wouldn't have to do, that they don't make any money off of, but just to show a humanity, a side of humanity a little bit. And they're this big macho guy. Like, you know, you see Shaquille O'Neal, this gigantic, you know, strong basketball player that could take any of us down in 3 seconds. But here he is, you know, every once in a while you'll see something where he's shown a gentler side of himself a little bit, you know, and I think that's important for these people to see that you don't have to be the warrior all the time. You can, you know, calm down. You can take a breath and you can be human. I think that's very important.
No, there's so much there. And I want to say thanks for sharing that time with you and whatnot. So going forward then, I mean, is there more to come from Resort TV? Have you got more in the pipeline and stuff? I want some inside info.
Yeah. So, you know, it's interesting. And you mentioned earlier about just how we stay ahead of the curve on the technology and everything. Part of that is me putting my technology geek to work, because even before YouTube, I would geek out about tech and I'd learn about things that, you know, people, it was just interesting to me. And it's like, no, I'm never going to use that information I learned about how cell phone signal works, but boy, I'm using it now, you know, so, you know, never going to use this and that, but I'm using all these things. So when I have learned about I think our app development is the biggest thing, that there's a lot of things to come from that, where we're getting this custom app developed. And you mentioned earlier that, you know, just kind of breaking down the boundaries of what we can and can't do on the stream. And one of the things we did several years ago was find a way to toss the stream back and forth without using a central control computer. You know, you can do it with somebody on a desktop computer, but that's pretty clunky when you're having to call over like at a live broadcast and say, okay, switch it over to Jenna. Okay, switch it over to Josh. You know, we don't have headsets like a TV studio. So we needed to find another way to do that. So we found that. But other things, you know, coming down the pipeline, like I've done some 360 degree streams, which are not everybody's cup of tea because, you know, it can be disorienting, especially if you have motion sickness. So that will never be our main, you know, type of streaming, but it's something I want to do more often for those people that are able to watch it in VR and all that, for people that are comfortable with it. I think it's cool to see the parks in a more immersive way. I think other than that, I'm trying to think of what else might be coming. Just really, my idea, you know, is to try and remove as many barriers between people watching and the parks as possible. Obviously, we can't do smell-o-vision yet. People talk about, oh, I walk through Pirates of the Caribbean and I know what that smells like, you know, and that kind of thing. So you just have to rely on your memory for now. But otherwise, you know, I really just want to, I think our biggest focus right now is giving people the best experience possible on the channel with what we have. And one of the things, having the different channels, it's allowed us to focus on a smaller audience. So people that are willing to follow me to the Retro Tech channel, or follow Jenna to her channel, Adventures of Jen and Dale, or follow us to the Resort TV One Homes, even if you're never going to move to Florida, you know, maybe just learning more about Florida, it allows us to maybe interact with people in a different way. So those are, I'm not saying we're going to start a bunch of new channels, but that, I think this is it for now. But just finding ways really to connect with people in different ways. The technology, you know, it moves slowly sometimes. So I don't see any major technological advances other than hopefully cell signal will improve and maybe we can stream in higher quality.
Yes. Yeah. Smell-o-vision. Yep.
Yep.
Yeah.
So other than that, you know, I think we're just going to really, you know, continue to try and innovate in how we show things and find different ways. One of the things we try and do, you know, I see a lot of streams, they do a good job, but it seems like a lot of what they do is the same a lot. And I try to really, not that we do some things that are the same. It's good to have that old comfortable feeling, but also I try and, you know, do some different things. Like, you know, we went to, you know, we go to Disney Springs and ride a boat around the resorts like we did the other night, or, you know, do a resort transportation challenge, or, you know, all just whatever we can think of to say, okay, we've been to Magic Kingdom, you know, we're always going to go there a bazillion times, but what can we do that's different? You know, I think that's my question I was asked myself.
And I know Jack's got a question.
So I wanted to ask you, you know, over the years that you've been doing this, what's been a standout moment that like springs to mind for you?
I mean, I think, you know, obviously I mentioned the one earlier, obviously I'll never forget the conversation, you know, the emotional conversations for sure. And there's been a few of those, but outside of that, I think the biggest things have been just, you know, milestones that we've reached, hitting 100,000 subscribers in line for Pirates of the Caribbean. I know exactly the spot we were standing when we did it. And just thinking about we could fill a couple sports stadiums with the people that are subscribed to us right now. And that was just mind blowing to think of. I grew up in a town of 20,000 people. And so it's five times as many people that are in the town that are subscribed to us. And now it's nine times as many almost. So it's staggering. I think just hitting those milestones, that is really cool. The other standout moments, I'd say probably the first time we got to go to a Disney media event, and it was like, whoa, we're sitting here next to like such and such magazine and such news channel and all these different people. And it just like, wow, we're like legit now. That was kind of cool. And Disney was so welcoming, and we got to see the Star Wars Star Cruiser Hotel, even though it's closing. We got to see it before anybody else did. We had to sign a contract and the NDA and all that stuff that we would not post anything until such and such day and such time, because nobody had seen it. And, you know, and then when we had the video, I'll never forget these either. When we did the video premiere, once there was like 9 o'clock Friday morning, we could post. That was when the ban was lifted. And so we posted it right there at 9 o'clock. And some of the Imagineers that we had interacted with there were in the live stream chat, or the live premiere chat, saying, oh, I'm so glad you enjoyed it and all this stuff. And I thought, how cool was that? They wanted to check out somebody's reaction to their work like an artist would. And they are artists, but Sorry, go ahead.
I was just saying, you know, you actually, I mean, those that haven't experienced Disney and the work that I know it's not cheap and whatnot, but the work that goes into the parks, the rides, the theming, the smells, you know, you can go down, you know, you go around Epcot and how it's all themed with the food. There's so much work goes into it, and you were right to have that. How did it feel?
You know, it's just. Go ahead.
No, I was just saying, how does it feel for you personally? It's like knowing that you've got these people here and they've come to see your reaction. How did that feel?
It's pretty incredible, honestly. Like, you know, the Imagineers, when we were on the Star Cruiser, they were like big kids walking, running around playing with this stuff. And they played with the different video games and things that were there. And literally, like, we did all these, you know, quests and challenges, and they were playing right along with us. Oh, we got to stop the dark side. We got to go rescue Chewbacca. All these things. They were 100% into it. And, you know, that's one of my strengths actually as a teacher is, you know, you mentioned reading, Jack, you mentioned reading faces. That's something that I was blessed with the ability to do as well. And so I'm watching these people and just seeing like what their reactions were and how genuine they were and whatever. And what I loved watching these Imagineers is you can tell they genuinely 100% are committed and love what they do. And they were into it just like a kid on Christmas Day. And that to me was really rewarding to see. You know, some of the other things too, I think that happen on the streams that are a lot of fun. Just when Jen and I will have a moment where we just kind of lose it and just start laughing hysterically. I think there's times when, you know, you get the live bloopers that are happening live and then we just can't stop. There was one time when we'd had some lag in the stream and the signal wasn't working right, and we missed part of the fireworks show and things like that that just normally happen. And so at the end of the stream, Jenna was trying to wrap it up and she said, all right, guys, well, we've had so much trouble. And she meant so much fun, but she said, we've had so much trouble. And then we both stopped and looked. He's like, trouble, so much trouble. And we just laughed for like 5 minutes and we couldn't bring it back to any kind of composure or whatever. But that turned out to be this wonderful moment of release for people. I think it's like, okay, we're all human. We all make mistakes. And then there was just this uncontrollable laughter, you know, cause she just shoved it in there like it was nothing. Like, well, okay, guys, we've had so much trouble and we just lost it. So those are the moments I think that are fun and that stand out.
And kind of the moments that show
your favorite ride is the people
that are genuine as well. Like you, people are watching and they're getting a genuine reaction from you. Then you know what I mean? It's not scripted, and that's why we don't do any of that here. We don't script any pre questions. We have like a rough idea of a conversation, but that's it. Because again, you get the genuine article. You get that genuine person that they're listening and seeing. And we have had a couple of, as soon as we put up saying that you was coming on to have a discussion, we've had some good interest, to be fair, and we've got a couple of questions. I want to throw a question at you from one of your listeners. So this has come from Instagram, and it is from username is CleeCleeTime, which I think is amazing. What a name. But they've said, what tips does Josh have for keeping calm amidst the chaos of Disney parks?
That's a great one. Yeah. Especially if you're the person who kind of person who gets overwhelmed easily with this kind of stimuli and things. I think the best thing to do is if you start to get overwhelmed, you need to go find a quiet place off to the side, which can be difficult. And that's why I think it's important to know the parks as, really well, and just have a seat and just, take it all in for a minute. Grab a beverage, whatever you need to do, and just sit. Because I think everybody gets wrapped up and we only have this many days left. We have, we only have 43 hours left at Disney or whatever. They've got the countdown in their brain going, and I get that. But if you're getting overwhelmed amidst the chaos and you just keep pushing yourself, you're not going to have a good time. So I really, really advise people, if you're getting overwhelmed or you're getting annoyed or you're getting hot and tired or whatever, find a place, an air-conditioned place or whatever. Get a beverage, get something, just sit with your family. If it takes you, if you need to be, you need to stare at the phone for a second, you need to look, just watch people walk by, whatever you need to do to just kind of remove yourself from the chaos for a minute. I think that's really, really good. The other thing is just to find something to focus on. I'll give you an example. I'm standing on Main Street USA with 40,000 of my closest friends, on Main Street, and you have this really. It would be very easy for somebody. It's kind of like looking at a picture of Times Square. It'd be very easy for somebody to get overwhelmed in that and say, "Oh my gosh, I'm panicked right now because I'm in this group," And there's been times when I would get pushed or jostled around, and I'll get like, "Oh my gosh, this is a little bit freaky." Then I find something to focus on. Like I'll look at the castle, and I said, "There's the castle. That's kind of my anchor. That's like I see that right there. It's not going anywhere. I'm fine here where I am. I'm gonna get a move when this is over, and it's okay." So there's those kind of times. The other thing is, if you are the kind of person who can't deal with crowds, you go watch the fireworks somewhere else. You go watch it behind the castle. You go watch it, wherever else you can. You can see them from multiple locations. They play the music all over in the park. You also, the other thing I always tell people, the number one cardinal sin, worst mistake anybody makes at Disney, number one thing, do not leave after the fireworks ever. It's just not a good idea. You can leave before. You can leave during. You can't leave after. If you stay for the fireworks, you're going to have to stay an extra a half hour to an hour. And I mean, sure, you can leave, but that's when a lot of unpleasant things happen, unfortunately. People are hot, tired, annoyed, cranky, all these things. And not just, I'm not talking about just altercations, obviously that happens, but I'm talking about just unpleasant things happen. People are rude and things, or you're just waiting in a line when you could be enjoying the park. So everybody's like, "I got to get home. I'm tired." Yes, but you're going to be waiting in a really obnoxious line for 40 minutes. Or you could grab a beverage and you could sit on Main Street somewhere and you could just watch the world go by for a second and then walk out there and you still waited the same amount of time. So I think that's what people don't get is, if I get there first, you're not going to get there first. So that's my biggest thing. Don't leave after the fireworks. It's the worst thing you can possibly do.
You're going to have thousands of people now standing there all waiting for you to leave first next time you go. Well, Josh told us not to leave after the fireworks, so I'm going to stand here for
No,
an
you leave,
hour
yeah.
and see if when he moves. And it'd be like a big herd of sheep just following each other around the park. It'd be amazing.
It's my fault. Sorry, Disney.
No, for me, I was just, before Jack brought that question, I was just, I mean, a couple of things that come to mind with yourself. It's how you still find enjoyment no matter how many times you do it. It's things like the People Mover. I know that's one of your all-time favorite rides, and it's just you get on there and you can hear it in your voice that you're just like a big kid that comes to life, and it's just how it takes you back. And I was watching it the other day where Jenna was on the on Space Mountain and the lights were on and stuff like that, and it was just it's just these moments you probably wouldn't get with a lot of the other channels. And I just think the way you bring that joy and that love, and I just think it's brilliant.
Well, thank you. I mean, it's I think that's the way that, if anybody, obviously with as many people as we have watching, we have people that don't like us and are, detractors or whatever you want to say. We don't pay much attention to that. But I think even the worst detractor would have to watch, and if they were really honest with themselves, say that we actually do enjoy doing this, and we actually,
Yeah.
Are not just doing it for money or anything like that, that, there's a genuine love for it. Because if it was just about trying to make money, there's so many other things you could do.
Yeah.
That would probably be way easier. So I think a lot of people don't realize how taxing mentally and physically it is doing what we do. And I always tell people, if we didn't love it, we wouldn't do it.
No.
There's a lot of other ways to make a living. So, and as I said, I'm a teacher too, but That's another one that's not easy either. But again, I love it. So that's why I do it, you know, so it's rewarding to us, and all the wonderful moments that we get to enjoy, you know, funny things on the stream, or, you know, all these things, it makes it worth it. So, but also, like you said, just riding a ride that we rode as a kid, we were lucky to go a lot as kids. So some of that stuff brings us back, even like we talked about the smells a minute ago, the smells bring you back, you know, and as I get older, I realize more and more like how powerful a smell can be. And you get this memory, and you, all of a sudden you're back in, you know, you're 10 years old again, you know, or you're 7 years old and you're enjoying this thing for the first time. So I think that's kind of what we go back to a lot of times when we get the childlike enjoyment a lot of times out of things.
Yeah, and I commented on, I think he was walking into Epcot, and I commented about the legacy pillars that are there and whatnot, and just seeing, you know, and you said, oh, they're over there. So and just seeing, you know, where they were once. I know they moved, but that takes me back to, I think it was 2000 when I first went to Disney. You know, I've been many times since, and I think it was back in 2015 I did the Dopey Challenge, so Epcot. You know, 5K, 10K, half marathon, and marathon all around the parks and stuff, and sharing that with my mom and my now wife and stuff like that. You know, I don't think there's anywhere else in the world that you can do the amount of things that Disney has to offer.
No, I agree. I've said this before. I mean, Magic Kingdom, of course, but Epcot. I've said this before. There is no place in the world where you can go watch a world-class concert and then go have cuisine from 8 different countries. I mean, at least no place in the world I know of, you know, that's like Epcot. And then you can go ride a Disney ride, and then you can meet Mickey Mouse all in the same park. You know what I mean? Like there's all these things that I think make Disney unlike anything else. And sure, I know very well, you know, it's not everybody's cup of tea. And certainly I think that's another thing about the channel that, you know, growing up, we would go to Disney all the time, and people, you know, even at our church or at our, you know, school or in our, you know, people we knew, you know, mom and dad's work, and they would always be like, you're going to Disney again, you know, and there's so many other places you could go. But I think for us, you know, being around people who understand the magic and the draw of Disney, and having those people, obviously people that watch our channel are going to be people that on the whole, they enjoy Disney. and so being around a group of people like that, they get it. You know, when I get excited about People Mover, they can understand why. Or when I get excited about the fireworks I've watched the fireworks for the 150th time, but I'm still excited about it. You know, they understand why. So I think that's a big part of it too.
It brings back these core memories memories that you have as a child. And I know Ryan's going to have a question for you shortly again as well from another listener that's reached out, but I just wanted to, you know, on the topic of Disney and that, obviously there's been a lot of remakes of the old Disney classics and that. What are have you got any thoughts and opinions on them? Obviously, I know some of them have got bad press, which in my eyes is just ridiculous. But again, have you got any kind of thoughts and opinions with your expertise, because that's what you are, you're an expert in Disney and what you do. So yeah, have you got any thoughts or feelings on them?
I do. excuse me. I like the idea of doing them, and certainly, you know, obviously, like you said, a lot of the bad press was ridiculous. I mean, for me, I'm all about these beautiful shows. You know, Little Mermaid in general. Like I conducted Little Mermaid the musical at my school with a half professional and half student orchestra. It was a dream come true. It's a beautiful show, and I'll never hear part of your world the same again. When I conducted it and got to interact with the singer, we had this singer who's probably this young lady who's probably going to be on Broadway soon, you know, and she was that good that sung the role of Ariel. So, you know, for me, I love that they're keeping these amazing shows alive, you know, and the young lady they got to play Ariel did a fantastic job. And I think, you know, she really brought it to life in a different way, and it was great. So I don't have any problem with the remakes for that reason. That that's keeping these things alive that are really, really amazing masterpieces. My only issue is sometimes I think it comes at the detriment of new content and new material. And so I'd like to see, I'm not against remakes, but I'd like to see more original content. Having said that, I understand why Disney doesn't do that as much sometimes, because it's a risk. So you bring out something like Elemental that just came out that was an original concept, even though it was kind of like Inside Out. It was an original concept for the most part. It didn't do well, you know, so they're like, oh, I guess we better make another Frozen movie, you know, because we know that one will do well, you know. So I think that's it. I get the trap Disney's in, and I don't fault them. If I was in charge, I don't know if I'd have a better idea, but I probably wouldn't. So I think that's the conundrum they're in, is if we do these remakes, people are going to say we're not original, but we're going to make money on them. But if we do this original stuff, we run the risk of it just completely bombing, you know? So I don't know what the answer is. I think, unfortunately, it's going to take that Walt Disney level of investment where you say, Walt was quoted once as saying, you know, I had all these pictures lined up and I could fall on my face with one and there'd be another one right behind it that would hit. And I think that was how Walt was so successful. He had unsuccessful movies. People don't remember that. There were movies that Walt helped make that didn't do well, and that's okay. You know, so I think that people think that everything that he ever did was just absolutely perfect, and he would be the first to tell you, no, it's part of the learning process, having something. But I think the difference was they were just so prepared to just try new things and see what worked. And I think there's a lot less experimentation now than what there could be. So I hope that they will get back to that at some point a little bit. But yeah, I love the remakes that they've done so far.
It was like, I will come to that question, but just something you said, it was like when they first built the park, wasn't it? It wasn't complete when they opened the doors. It wasn't complete. It was, you know, they were still building rides. There was still wet paint everywhere and stuff like that. And it was just, you know, and there's plenty of stuff out there. And I think that just proves your point, what you're saying. It's take a little bit of extra risk, and I think they'll be rewarded for it a lot more.
Absolutely.
So to the question then, this has come from somebody called Braden in New York, and he's gone on to say, sorry, I'm new here. I heard Josh from Resort TV One is coming onto the show. I can't thank Resort TV One enough for how it's helped my mental health. This is really good news that he's agreed to this, and my level of respect for him has gone through the roof. Does he find juggling his school life, his family life, and Resort TV One too much at times?
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. Last year was probably one of the hardest years I've had in my entire career, and it showed a couple times. You know, I will say that, you know, I had, I don't know if you call it an outburst or two, where I lost my patience a few times because it was just too much on the stream. And you know, even just in May, I think it happened a couple times, and in March, then, you know, and I was hospitalized for anxiety in March. I thought it was a heart attack. Thankfully it wasn't. But after that, I really took a step back and said, okay, what is going on right now? I sat in the back of the ambulance and said, if this is really a heart attack, none of this stuff that I'm worried about matters at all. It's just gone. It's just white. It's like you just wiped the desk. You know, you took all this stuff and just wiped it right off your desk. And that's kind of, in my mind, that's kind of what happened. So that hospital visit was definitely a reset for me of, you're taking all these, you, me, and me, or I'm taking all these things way too seriously that I'm worried about. And, you know, pressures in the job. One of my best friends that I worked with got very ill and had some really bad health issues. Luckily, he's okay now, but that was causing a lot of stress. My dog of almost 16 years passed away, you know, and then just lots of pressure at work from a lot of different forces that were happening. You know, they're making things difficult in certain ways. And just it mounted to a point where, you know, I remember why the anxiety attack happened. Actually, I was stressing myself out about being to the stream on time. You know, what a silly thing. I'm 5 minutes late to the stream. Nobody's going to, you know, it's not going to hurt anybody if I'm 5 minutes late to the stream. But I just had put that much pressure on myself to be perfect all the time in everything. When I finally realized this, you know, Josh, nobody could do what you're doing and be perfect at it all the time. Nobody could do the amount of stuff you're doing and be perfect at it all the time. So I had to allow myself some grace. And I had to say, it's okay if I'm a little bit late, if I've had the best intentions. And it's not to say, you know, you don't slip the other way either and say, I'm just going to not care about anything. I think it's important, you know, to, when you have those moments of clarity, you swing to the middle and not to the other side and say, well, I don't care about anything anymore. No, that's not the appropriate response. It's, you know, as long as I have the good intentions to do my best, I can give myself some grace if it doesn't always work out. And that's, I think, what I finally come to with all the juggling of everything, is that I'm going to do my best, but I'm also going to take a step back and say, okay, I didn't quite get that done. I'm going to get to it, but I'm going to take a breath right now. And there's times when it's been, you know, 1 a.m. or 12:30 and said, I haven't gotten done whatever I need to get done, but I'm going to go to bed anyway. It's okay. You know, so those are some times I've just given myself a lot more grace. And I think it's important for everybody to do that, because, you know, if you're type A plus like me, you push yourself really hard, and it's just not sustainable.
I think that's a massive point to put put forward, is being able to have that break. We found that when we, again, when we first started this, we was getting such a buzz from it, and it was like our weekly counseling sessions, we was enjoying it so much. We literally went 6 months straight, like every week recording, getting out, doing our day job, looking after the family. And it got to a point where we both like turned around to each other and went, we need a break. We need to take a step back. It's gone too quick. Mm-hmm. And it was so nice to see that we had learned so much about ourselves and each other during that 6 month period, that we could go, you know what, this is getting too fast. We need to take a step back. And we did. We had that month or so off just to regroup, look after our own mental health and our own state and that, because again, that's what we push. And then come back. And again, recently for me, it's happened again. I've done so much throughout, it was like last month, throughout June, I moved. I was back at my old job, and then I had family, and then financial worries, and then trying to do this. And I had another full on kind of breakdown, to where I'm now gone back to counseling to go, right, you know, let's learn the reason why, so then I can put into place the how and the knowledge and that. So again, people look at myself and Ryan and think, you know, oh, they're doing absolutely fantastic, they sound great on the podcast, but in the background, we're still having our bad days, we're still fighting the demons every day. So again, we have to put stuff into place to go, do you know what, it doesn't matter if a podcast doesn't sound amazing orderly, it doesn't matter if that post we put on social media isn't fantastic, because I'm like you, and Ryan will probably admit and then agree with this, like if I'm not on time, if it's not perfect, I have a full-on meltdown. And Ryan's like, hey, just take a step back, we're all human, this is bringing out your human side, which interacts with people a lot better. And I'm like, yeah, no, but inside that noggin, it's all different, it's all like, no, this has to be this has to be that. And before we come on to kind of like the final thoughts and everything, I want to ask, like, if you could put down your top three, what are your top three Disney films? Old and new as well. Old and new.
Oh boy. You know, it's really old and new for sure. For sure. Oh boy. Yeah. On the spot. You know, I have to, I'm going to think strictly Disney. I'm not going to include Star Wars and all these kind of things in there, because, you know, technically Disney, but I'm going to go with just Disney. So nobody say, you didn't say Star Wars. No, this, I'm separating that. So, cause there's no way I could do three if I included Star Wars. So, but as far as top three, I would say number one for me is probably Peter Pan, just cause it's such a classic. The music to me gets me every time. The, you know, when it's that old style choir harmony music and the strings and everything. And it's just so classic, the animation and the story and everything. And so, yeah, Peter Pan, probably number one. I would say number two is probably one that a lot of people are not as familiar with, and that would be Meet the Robinsons, which was not as popular, but it was a big tribute to Walt. It was all about keep moving forward. And I think that's the whole motto of the whole thing. And that's kind of my motto, is keep swimming, keep moving forward, keep going, you know? And so I like Meet the Robinsons for that message, and that very positive message. It's so different from the other shows too. There's no princess, there's no, you know, there's no knight in shining armor, there's not really, I mean, there's a villain, but it's just not the same. It's not the same old thing. It's very, very different. And as far as number three, boy, I'm thinking classics like, you know, Beauty and the Beast and Aladdin and some of those, and they're all great. But I probably would have to say, just because I conducted at the Little Mermaid, because the music is so special to me now. But if I had to have an honorable mention, it'd probably be Inside Out, just because I love the way that they go through the feelings in that one. But yeah, so anyway, that's my three plus an honorable mention.
I love it.
I'm going to add one into there. And mine is Pete's Dragon.
Oh yeah, that's a good one. Yeah,
yeah. And again, it's one of them films where there's no princess, but that you've got PD, you've got Pete's Dragon and whatnot. But then you've got the Gogons, and I just think they're some of the ultimate sort of bad guys in Disney. If nobody's mm-hmm. watched it, not the new one, the original. I know
the original.
Passer McQuaddy, you can't beat it. So
I agree. That's a good one.
There you go. There you go. Josh agrees. I like it.
That's it. You just made his head go even bigger.
That's fanboy ticked.
Sorry about that.
It's all right. No, it's absolutely fine. So anything from you, Jack?
All I can say, Josh, and I know Ryan's going to ask for your last kind of thoughts and feelings, but I just want to say thank you. One, for taking the time to come and speak to us, but two, for everything you've done over the past years to make Resort TV One what it is, and what you have done for hundreds and thousands of people out there that I guarantee when they listen to this, they'll be like, ah, Josh, thank you. Thank you so much. And so on behalf of them, I want to thank you and all of your family as well for what you do.
That's our pleasure. And thank you so much. I appreciate that.
So, yeah, and I want to talk more of on a personal level, you know, there's especially the recent weeks is, you know, my wife's been really good with the newborn and whatnot, but there's been a couple of nights where I've been sat there and I've been like, oh, just go to sleep and put you on. And just like the walking around has kind of mesmerized him a little bit and put him to sleep and stuff. So, you know, up until recently, it's really helped me as well, you know, through COVID and stuff, you know, it brought me sort of joy and stuff. But have you kind of got any final thoughts, Josh? Have you got any sort of, you know, any final words of inspiration, so to speak?
Yeah, I mean, I really appreciate everybody supporting us the way they have in the past several years. I never dreamed it would be like this, but I think if people take anything away from from what we do and from, you know, from our message, I think it is what I said earlier, is keep moving forward. And you know, there's always the great, we always say have a great big beautiful tomorrow at the end of our streams, and that's just, it's just so true. There always is a great big beautiful tomorrow. And even if today wasn't so great big and beautiful, you know, there's always you know, something just around the corner that'll change things and make things, you know, even better than you ever thought. You know, I mentioned on the stream I've had something really difficult come up in the last few weeks, or in the last week or so. And, you know, I keep reminding myself of the same advice, is that, you know, there's a reason for everything. And, you know, even if you can't see the reason right now, you know, it will be okay. And, I think it's important to just find things that make you happy. Realize that you deserve to be happy. No matter how much you mess up, we all mess up, you still deserve to be happy. And allow yourself to do that. You know, that's the other thing. We're our own worst critics sometimes. I've had to allow myself to be okay with not being perfect. And so I think that's another message I'd leave with people too, is be okay with not being perfect. Allow yourself to be happy, and keep moving forward. And if you can do that, well, you know, you're going to be in a lot better shape, I think. And obviously nothing's ever perfect, but I think that's the whole point of it. And it's just acknowledging. The other thing is just talking to people like this, you know. Be vulnerable with somebody you feel comfortable with, and talk about, you know, when you're not feeling great, it's okay. You know, you don't have to say it in front of thousands of people like we do, but you know, certainly find somebody to talk to. And it's really important to do that. So.
Well, so I have to say, I think this has been one of my favorite episodes. You know, so Josh, for me personally, so I want to say thank you. Thank you for coming on to the show. Thank you for continuing to do everything. And I'm going to close the show, but I'm actually going to close the show a little bit different today to how I normally close it. And I'm going to say, guys, stand up, speak out, but always have a big, beautiful tomorrow.